throughout the 80s and into the 90s, Selma, to keep Vital Options going, keep it alive, she put together these amazing, amazing evenings called Dance for Life. Selma really taught us all how to dance for life. And you can see the posters around the room, and you can look at the talent that she was able to attract and be a part of this incredible journey that she was on. But in order to pull all of this off, Selma, for the first time, actually reached out for some extra help. She turned to a very good friend, a television producer, mostly reality shows, and had done concerts and things, Scott Sternberg, who not only embraced Dance for Life, embraced Selma, and embraced being a member of the board, and is currently, as well, today sits on the board. So it's my pleasure to introduce the producer of Dance for Life and a great friend, Scott Sternberg.
I love Selma Schimmel, and here's why. I first met Selma Schimmel back in 1985, when my good friend Howard Stevens, who at the time was working at KCBS, called me and asked if I would be interested in helping out and be a volunteer for a charity and an event being put together by Vital Options. I asked what it was, and he said it was a nonprofit support group for young adults with cancer. I asked him if he was also going to help out, and he said yes, absolutely. Seemed reasonable and meaningful, and I had never really been part of anything like this before, and was intrigued by its mission. I said I would be happy to help in some small way and would volunteer to be part of it. I was busy at the time producing a TV show called Love Connection, where singles would get a chance to date somebody on TV, then come to the studio, tell about the date, and sit with host Chuck Woolery, who was more interested in saying, "We will be back in 2 and 2. How did the date end? Was there a love connection? And would you like to go out with him or her again?" Clearly, support for young adults with cancer was a hell of a lot more important than love connection, but it was my livelihood at the time. It was really a lot of work, so whatever extra time I had between working and taking care of my one-year-old son would be minimal. He said that the founder of Vital Options, a Selma Schimmel, would be reaching out and calling me. I said, fine, but for her to please call next week, because I was really slammed at the time, and this was a Wednesday. He said he understood. An hour later, my assistant said there was a Selma Schimmel calling, and I would be reaching out and call, who would be reaching out and calling me. I said, fine, but for her, please call next week, as I was really busy. This was a Wednesday. And please call back on Monday, where I'll have a little more time. At 3 p.m., my assistant said Selma Schimmel was calling and just needed a minute to chat. Again, I said, I understand it's important, but I cannot talk until Monday. Please tell her that. And I would be happy to call her directly. At 5 p.m., call number 3 came in, where my assistant said, it's that Selma woman again. So now we've gone from Selma Schimmel to just Selma in just a few hours. I responded by saying, listen, I don't know her, and how have we gone from two names to just one? Like Bette and Cher and Reba and Oprah. I begged that Monday we would talk, but not now. At 6 p.m., another call. It might as well have been Queen Elizabeth, as she called me for the fourth time. I finally got on the phone with this persistent, pushy, and over-the-top lady. That was enough. I was ready to tell her that I must pass on being a lowly volunteer. It was just not going to work. She said, "Thank you for taking my call," a normal phrase that Selma would use. She said, "Thank you for coming on to help me on this new project she was calling Dance for Life, and wanted to congratulate me for accepting the position of not just the producer, but the director as well." What the hell are you talking about, lady? I love Selma Schimmel. That was the beginning for us just 29 years ago. What followed were many successful Dance for Life events, with guests ranging from Michael Bolton to Paula Abdul to Liza. Of course, panic and urgency was part of Selma's MO when she came running to me backstage one year, screaming, "Liza is drunk and she needs to go on right now or she is going to leave. Do something, Scott. I'm just a volunteer. I couldn't leave her. Oy vey," is what I said to myself. What else is new? I spoke to Liza in her drunken state as Selma continued to check her hair, makeup, and asked simultaneous to me, the same time I was talking to Liza, "What do you think about my speech?" Did I say I love Selma Schimmel? Raising money for Vital Options via Dance for Life became our thing, and a relationship with Selma, who, as you know, when she called you, was at least an hour and a half of telephone conversation about everything. You could count on it. As our relationship progressed, she would call for all kinds of things and advice where I never, nor would I, say no. Saying no, as we all know, is a dirty word to Selma. Her face would tilt to the right, and her eyes would go into that pleased and teary look like a little puppy, and you were stuck. Then one day, I get a call from her, and she says, "I have an idea for a radio show." I said, "Yeah?" And she told me her concept for the group room. I said, "Sounds good." And she said, "When can we start?" "We? Hold on, daughter of a rabbi. What do you mean, we?" The following week, we were in a small radio station in Sherman Oaks, literally rehearsing, as she got her friend Tim, a great and generous man who owned Premier Radio Networks, and he put her on the air. He did, and she did what she set out to do: succeed and invite the entire world to listen. In the meantime, as she was getting ready, "How's my hair? How's my makeup? You better call Daniel. Hurry up, call Daniel. What should I wear? Selma, it's radio." Exactly. That didn't faze her a bit, and again, as we know, so with a little help from her friends, the group room was born and she was heard and seen as cameras were also introduced. It grew and grew from childhood to adulthood. When I actually saw it on a plane one time, I was filled with excitement for my dear friend. And by the way, hair, makeup, wardrobe, perfect. Years would fly by and we would always talk creatively about things, which I finally started to really enjoy. Some things happened and others did not, but the collaboration was fun. She quickly became a close family friend to my wife Nikki and I, so we visited on holidays, had dinners, and all kinds of great things for us to share, which also included some Thai restaurant somewhere in Encino where she forced me to eat fried tofu. I said to her, "No," 16 times. I ate it. Ugh. Nothing's changed at all. Towards the end, she would discuss with me when she was going to die. She said, "Not this year, but maybe next." I, of course, said, "What the hell are you talking about? You have survived 14 chapters of this disease and you are not allowed to die." I never wanted to believe that it could happen until Nikki and I went to the hospital to see her. I said selfishly to myself, "This is where she wakes up and says, 'Do you have time to talk?'" But this time it wasn't to be. Thank you to the amazing and caring Debbie and Ken. who sat patiently on vigil, and to the extraordinary Terry Wolcox, who never wavered to continue the support or the work till the very end. And of course, Derek, board members, and all of you who've supported Selma all these years. You were very important and still very important to her. I loved Selma Schimmel for who she was and her determination to make her work count every single day. However, I did not realize until I wrote this that that very pushy fourth call from her on a Wednesday was really our love connection. And yes, Chuck Woolery, I would like to go out again and again with Selma as many times as I possibly can.